Hi, this is Scott Jordan, and you are watching live here at Sellers of Sonoma in beautiful Railroad Square, Santa Rosa, California. Welcome to TV Tuesday Live. This is the show where we taste wine, we talk about wine, and I get to interview winemakers and chefs and people in the hospitality business. And tonight I've got one half of the Joseph Jewell and Adrian Manspeaker. Welcome to TV Tuesday Live.
Yeah, thanks, Scott. Thanks
for having me. To see you.
Yeah, you too.
Yeah. So a little chilly today, a little drizzle. You know, we're getting payback whenever I talk about the weather being so damn nice here, all our people from the east. Then all of a sudden I get a day like today, and it was cold, Dan. You would have hated it. It was probably like 60 or something. Yeah.
I had to put my sweater on because I was used to 75 degrees, so that starting to get used to the warmth, and then the cold comes back. So
well, we had a stellar weekend. I mean, gosh, we did a pickup party at James Vineyard up in Cotati, up on the hill. Normally that's real windy because that's that Petaluma Gap,
Yeah.
And stellar, like probably 75, 78 degrees.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, shout out to our wine club members, all of you that went to the event. It was a super big hit. And to my buddy Russ for helping me cook the chicken. We cooked, we barbecued chicken and had all kinds of salads and cool wines. One of yours was in the Hallberg, which we're not going to talk about tonight, but in a few weeks we'll have him come back and we'll talk about that new wine. But they liked it a lot.
Good.
So
that's great.
Yeah, two thumbs up on that. That's a stellar bottle of wine. So
All right. Thank you.
We're loving that. So we're gonna taste five wines today. We're gonna taste Sauvignon Blanc, Chardonnay, two Pinots, and then a Zinfandel. I'll warn some of you guys. Some of these are gonna be like the end of the vintage. And we talk about this every week, but when these wines are gone, he doesn't have a magic place to pull from.
Yeah.
They're gone.
I'm looking at this lineup tonight, and I don't have any more of it, to be honest. I have the 09 Floodgate is sold out, and so is the 08 Zinfandel, and the Sauvignon Blanc as well. So.
Well, that's a testament to you guys making killer wines. You're real consistent. You're getting great scores across the board on every one of these wines. And people love them here in the room, man.
Yeah,
and it just shows in sourcing and but really taking care of the wines.
Absolutely.
And in the cellar,
Yeah, we have preceding vintages of all these wines too, so that'll be the fun thing to go through and start the process of selling the new vintage and tasting the new vintage. Seeing what people, what their thoughts are and how it compares to the previous vintage.
Yeah, and some of those wines, for those of you that don't know, we keep a library selection here. So as we get these verticals, those are the fun things you want to collect.
Yeah.
And a little shout out to Brad Harder, who was here, came up to the picnic, the pickup party. And we filled some holes in his library and got some verticals going. So, oh yeah, it's really nice. And he's taking full advantage because he really understands how the club works and the limited production wines. Because really, seriously, when they sell out of here, they're gone.
Yeah,
and you can't go back and get those. So let's talk about 2009 Sauvignon Blanc. Tell us, everybody, where this is from and how you're producing this. The style of this 09?
Yeah, so the our Sauvignon Blanc comes from a vineyard called Redwood Ranch, which is Alexander Valley. We've got three rows exclusively that we source within this vineyard. It's a it's a fairly large vineyard that supplies some of the larger wineries. But Jim Reed, the owner, works with us side by side on the farming practices of this vineyard. We're shooting for a more tropical style Sauvignon Blanc than the New Zealand style, the grassy and a little bit herbaceous style. This is a little more grapefruit, citrus.
Oh yeah, grapefruit all day.
Good acidity, And you know, it's stainless steel fermented, so it doesn't see any oak. It's not the big creamy texture Fumé Blanc. So,
what are you doing with this wine to get away from the New Zealand style? Is there a technique that you can tell us about?
Yeah, a lot of it has to do with you know, your farming practices and pulling leaves from blocking sunlight from hitting the clusters.
Okay.
So in New Zealand style, you tend to keep the sunny side, the south side, in this instance, pretty covered, so the clusters don't see much sun. So they end up being kind of grassy and green.
Okay.
But if you allow a little bit of sunlight to hit the clusters, it breaks down some of those compounds that are developing those green flavors.
Okay.
And they disappear, and then you end up with these more tropical style flavors. So it's tricky because you can't let it get too ripe. So the riper it gets, it becomes kind of tropical. But then there's too ripe with Sauvignon Blanc, and then it really kind of becomes lifeless. So it's a fine line that we're balancing
that. And you're growing that in a region that's can be pretty warm.
Yeah.
I mean, Alexander Valley can heat up. I mean, the fog comes in. Karina, let me get a shot so everybody can see what we're talking about at Alexander Valley, since I have these very expensive maps here and I need to use them. Alexander Valley is here. The ocean is way over there. Mm-hmm. So it's quite a ways in.
It's by the G on Healdsburg.
Oh, okay. So it's right here. Okay.
Well, and across the
east of the river.
East of the river.
So
okay.
Right there.
Right in here.
Yep, that's
okay.
River Branch.
So, you know, Alexander Valley can be pretty warm. I mean, the fog, you know, comes in later in the evening, burns off early in the morning.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful, you know.
Yeah, it's not as warm. If you go further north into Alexander Valley up by Cloverdale, that's the warmest part.
It's hot.
But, I mean, it is still much warmer there than Russian River Valley.
Yeah.
And for 2010 and 11, I think that was a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
In some vintages, it can be a little bit too warm. So yeah. It is a fine line there.
We're going to go to Karina for a question. Go ahead, Karina, fire away.
All right, so this question's coming from Cellar Mistress, and she would like to know, what's your favorite food pairing with the Sauv Blanc?
Well, for me, it's oysters.
Oh,
I don't know. I love oysters, but that's just kind of the crispness of this wine, the good acidity. That's real refreshing. It'll pair great with anything you can get from Hog Island or out on the coast.
Yeah.
Depending on where you live, but that's what we do. We go out to the coast and bring a bottle of Sauvignon Blanc. And
that rocks. Well, you know,
and pop oysters.
You know, we have sushi to die for right down the street. In fact, those of you that visit the tasting room, they now deliver full dinners right here to the tasting room,
which is
very cool.
Yeah.
Well, that would pair up quite nice with just about anything they've got rolling out of there.
Yeah. It'll handle spicy foods too.
I think so, right?
But my favorite pairing is oysters, but spicy foods or creamy cheeses.
Well, we're going to have oysters. Speaking of the lobster lunch, we've got the lobster lunch plugged back in, and that's that event. Right. We start out with the Hog Island oysters.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and the half shell, and then artisan cheeses.
Uh-huh.
And then they cook in big pots, lobster, shrimp, artichokes, potatoes, onion, corn on the cob, and throw it out on the table, and we just go buck wild.
That sounds fun.
It sounds good, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a cool event. So that's coming up June 29th. So get your tickets here, and that'll be an event that you will never, ever forget. And Sauvignon Blanc would be very good with that. Also, the Chardonnay, which we'll taste after this, could be very, very nice as well. Now, for the folks that don't know, when you come into the tasting room, you get to do flight tastings. We do them each day until 5 o'clock. The flight tastings include 4 wines. And we also do a food and wine pairing where we paired up from Jack and Tony's, our friend down the street, 4 different foods with 4 different wines, which is pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
And then we do a blind tasting, which we've been doing. Your wine was in there, of Zinfandel. And there we pour 4 wines. We don't tell you the order.
Uh-huh.
You guess the right order. Your tasting's free. If you're a wine club member, your tasting was already free, so we give you a glass of wine of your choice of that group. And then you get to enter a name into a hat for a drawing to buy a bottle of wine for $1. And we draw the name on the show. In fact, Karina's going to run downstairs for me at some point here. And to get that, because I want to pull a name. each week that we don't have a winner, because you have to be tuned in to win. So we make the, it's, you know, pretty tough. You got to tune in. Uh-huh. You can tune in on your cell phone. So don't give me any excuses about where you were. You could be driving down the freeway if you're a passenger and turn go right to the website and bam, you're on. So each week we don't have a winner. We add a bottle. And now we're up to eight tonight, eight bottles. So wow. It's getting serious. So you can't miss. Many of you that are tuned in that may not have tuned in the past got a little email from me because we pulled your name last week and the week before that. So I send you an email, let you know that we pulled your name. It's time to get back in the game. And it's a cool prize, really fun. Everybody has a good time with that. So we'll draw tonight for eight. And,
wow.
Yeah, so it's now it's getting serious. You know?
Yeah, I might have to start entering
you,
this.
I think you need to. In fact, we're going to change the blind tasting now. I'm going to go to Pinot. So I think you got a good shot of being one of
there
the
you
four
go.
Pinots in that group. So Sauvignon Blanc, hey, that's a great buy, guys. $24. You can't go wrong with that. If you're a Cellar Club member, you're getting that at $20.40. We can't argue at those kind of price points.
Yeah.
Got to love that.
Plus, it's gone now. So.
Yeah, it's gone. So you already missed it.
Yeah.
So, oh, that's beautiful. And, you know, the spring is coming for some of us. That's your beautiful summertime wine, man.
Absolutely.
Ready to rock and roll. And we will have the future vintages on those as well. So,
yeah.
Now, let's go to Chardonnay. And got Karina just coming back with our names in the bag. Look at that. This is crazy. You guys need to take a look at this, man. This is getting really serious. And there's a bunch of names that I pulled out of here. Because I pull your name, I hold you out until we get a winner, and then you go back in.
Okay.
So this isn't even all of it. This is just a small little segment, but it's starting
That's a couple years' worth of names? Or?
Yeah, that's a couple. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Oh, you want some wine? Is that what you're coming over here? All right. So this is a Chardonnay that we're doing, and I'd like to do something for all of you watching. And first of all, if you're at home and you're watching, would you do me a favor? Would you get out a bottle of wine real quick? If you don't have one out, it'd be kind of weird to watch a wine show, not drink wine. But if you do, would you please put a little wine in your glass? I want to do a little tribute to. One of the icons in the wine industry, Jim Barrett, last week on Thursday, passed away at I think he was 86. He passed away because he had a great life. I mean, the guy he has a beautiful family, and he, of course, was the owner of Chateau Montelena.
Mm-hmm.
Those of you that don't know, Chateau Montelena won the Paris tasting in 1976, and really, everything that we know about Napa and Sonoma County really took off when they won that Paris tasting. And that really put Napa on the map. And quite honestly, I don't think Napa and Sonoma would be what they are today if we hadn't had that recognition early on, don't you think?
I'm sure it jump-started the...
It clearly did. And they've been making great wines for a long, long time. And Heidi Barrett's one of our winemakers in the room. Of course, she's married to Bo Barrett. So... But I just wanted to do that. So I want to raise a glass, if we could. Everybody raise a glass. This is to Jim Barrett, an icon in the industry. He'll be missed, but we will think of him each time we drink. Mm-hmm. And we're drinking Chardonnay, which he was famous for. So hats off to the Barrett family. They had a big celebration. They probably had 500 people over there today.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was like crazy, crazy. Now, let's talk about Chardonnay. Joseph Jewell, 2011. Tell us about this wine and the style that you're doing in this wine.
Yeah, so it's a little bit different of style that maybe some people are used to with California Chardonnay. We stainless steel fermented this wine 100%, so it doesn't see any oak. We did a partial malolactic fermentation on it, which gives it a little bit more of a rich and round, creamy texture to it.
Okay, so you're keeping it in the stainless steel tank.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing your first fermentation.
Yeah.
And then what are you, heating it back up, heating the tanks back up? Or do you force it to go into a second?
Yeah, it spontaneously sometimes will go through ML.
Okay.
And so we let it kind of start
and
go through a little bit. Had a lot of malic acid in 2011, so it was really crisp and sharp acid and kind of unpleasant. So this was our first year making Chardonnay, so everything was kind of an experiment. You know, we had an idea of what we were looking for. But tasting
nice
the juice and tasting,
really
tasting the wine, you know, we kind of made decisions based on the taste, and that's what we always do that. So we decided to, you know, to do a partial ML on it, which I think is nice. You know, it's we're not alienating the people that like the big Chardonnays, and we're not saying this is a completely stainless steel, you know, Chablis style. It's kind of right in between.
Right.
It's got some texture. And if you told someone it didn't have oak, I've done this a lot where I've poured the wine for people. We didn't put no oak on the label for a reason. And that reason is because we don't want people who like barrel fermented Chardonnays to not enjoy ours.
Yeah.
And if you put no oak on it, people automatically aren't going to drink it. So we've had a lot of people, though, you know, come back and say they love it and then also tell us they're big, you know, Butterbomb fans. So
yeah.
It was nice to hear that people are, you know, enjoying the style, which is kind of in between of the French Chablis style, which is completely stainless steel fermented, and you know, kind of the California style.
Well, and I do the same thing in the tasting room all the time, because you know, people feel like they are in one camp.
Yeah.
But I'm surprised at so many that say, oh, I don't want an oaky, buttery Chardonnay, and I give them one that's got a little ML.
Yeah.
And they're going, that's what I want, and I'm like, okay, all right. So this does fit. Both camps.
Yeah.
And in that lobster lunch, that would be just dandy. Yeah. Richer Foods can handle that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Great price point. Retail on that is $22. $18.70 for a Cellar Club member, really? I mean, come on. All Russian River fruit. And moving forward, what do you got going forward on?
Yeah, we're this Chardonnay actually comes from one exclusive vineyard. So we've moved forward in the last two vintages with it. It's a vineyard called Shiloh Hill Vineyards. Mm-hmm. We did do six barrels of kind of a reserve in 2011, which we haven't released yet.
Oh, really?
But it's a very small amount of new oak, but it's a little bit different in style. But the grapes came from the exact same vineyard, so it's interesting to see.
And I've been over there. You had an event over there. Isn't that the place where you had your event over there?
Yep.
That's a
nice hillside.
I get to go to the coolest spots. I just have to tell you guys, you have no idea. Well, Brad knows because he went to James' property. These properties are so amazing, and they're not open to the general public. It's just, you know, you got to know someone, and I got to go, but that's pretty cool. It's a great spot.
No, it's really nice, and it's got, you know, western exposure on a very steep hillside. The vineyard's planted. To, you know, 100% Chardonnay. It was planted in 92, so the vines are, you know, 20 years old. Great slopes. We get, you know, we pick several particular blocks within the vineyard. We don't source all the fruit. It's 6 acres, so it's about 20 tons a year. We're you know, taking about 8 tons a year and making Chardonnay out of it. So it's
nice.
We pick the best blocks within the vineyard.
Nice. It's nice to have that connection.
Yeah, because
you know, for a small producer like yourself, you've got to have these really good connections, or you're going to be left in the dust.
Yeah.
You know, you can't bring in lousy fruit and try to make good wine. Dude.
No, you can't do it.
We talk each week about 2012. What's your thought? You've had a little time to play around.
Yeah.
With the 2012, what's your thought? Where do you think we're going with that?
Well, we already bottled the 2012 stainless steel fermented Chardonnay, and I like it better than the 11.
Nice.
And
was it because of the yields or what?
It's just a little more citrus driven. Mm-hmm. It's got a little more fruit on the nose. I mean, I love the 11 right now too. I shouldn't say that it's better, but I just at this point in the game. You know, last year where the 11 was and where the 12 was at the same time frame, I think the 12s are going to be great. So all of the Pinot Noirs are phenomenal. They're going to be, you know, very delicate, elegant style.
Nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
That's real sellable.
Yeah.
We can do that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hell yeah, that's good. Oh, that's so great.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I'm happy with the 12 Pinots as well.
I'm hearing great things across the board. It's one of those vintages you'd love to repeat, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Well, we got whacked pretty good 11, 2010.
It's not going to happen again. There'll be a curveball this year for sure. I was talking with one of our growers, Kirk Locke at Emeritus, and he was just saying how the crops are going to be probably half of what they were last year. It's just the way it is. And,
wow.
You know, and we had, you know, a good year last year, and he says this year is going to be, you know, it's going to be low yields.
Now, we're seeing bud break a little bit.
Yeah.
Are you seeing that out there on most of your stuff?
Yeah, a little bit here and there.
Yeah.
It's starting to show.
Okay. Rain an issue. We've got a little rain coming up, you know, probably real. I mean, this wasn't even rain. It was like drizzle, you know, it was like nothing.
It shouldn't be an issue.
Shouldn't be an issue.
Not at this point. Now, you know, hail or something like that could break the little shoots that have just developed, but rain won't be a problem unless it's crazy
rain.
I don't even think that would be a problem. You know, frost at this point would be a problem.
Well, but you know, around here, well, of course, when we get it rain, the temperatures start to go up a little bit.
Yeah,
and it's been pretty warm. It's been pretty.
Yeah,
nice.
I think we're gonna be fine. You know, this is a normal year. The last 2 years, bud break was more into April, so that's, you do want bud break a little bit later, just so that you kind of get out of that window of frost, which I think can happen up to May. So we're, you know, now it's all the vineyard guys have their sprinkler alarms and their temperature alarms that go off.
So what are your vineyard managers doing for frost control? What would be a typical?
A lot of them don't have it, you know. It's expensive. You can run fans, or you can run irrigation sprinkler heads that go and cool down the vine. Mm-hmm. But none of our vineyards have that, really.
Wow.
So
you're at the mercy.
Yeah. I mean, there's other things that can be done. They can put sprays on the vine that will work, but it only works up until a rain, and then if it rains, it washes it off. You have to spray it on again. It doesn't really work down below 30 degrees, so you're saving about 2 degrees. If it gets down into the 20s, you're screwed anyway.
Exactly. We have another question. Let's go to Karina.
All right, so Dizelle, aka My Vine Spot, is wondering if you guys utilize oak alternatives for vanilla spice, or and what are your thoughts on alternatives?
That was a thought when we started to make this stainless steel Chardonnay. Everybody was saying, oh, you need to do oak in some fashion. And a couple of my winemaking buddies had turned me on to some oak products, but I felt that really just took the romance out of winemaking by throwing chips and dust and stuff in fermenter.
Can't go.
So we don't. No, it's only oak barrels, French oak barrels, if we're gonna impart oak in any way.
So. Yeah, and you can use a neutral barrel or something that's too overdone, but it's again, you didn't need to in this scenario because you started that secondary fermentation, and you know, that gave it a little hint.
Yeah, it really helped out with the texture.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, a great wine, great price point, $22, $18.70. This is going to be gone soon, and we'll be into the 12. Now, will we see the reserve and the 12 at the same time, or what are you going to do with that?
Yeah,
or
next
is that
month.
A secret? Okay.
Next month.
Okay.
The 12 will probably be more of a summer, kind of like, release of its own.
Okay.
Just because we don't want to release two Chardonnays in the same release.
Yeah.
So.
And another question. Go ahead there, Karina. Fire away.
All right. Deanna would like to know, or he would like to have you describe three characteristics of all of the wines in your portfolio that you hope your fans will find.
Oh, well,
three
there you go.
Different characteristics
in
within
your wine.
Each
of,
like,
in
what's
of
the
them.
Underlying
yeah.
characteristics? Well, I definitely think they're on the, you know, elegant, yet still intense and unique. So those are probably the three descriptors I would use.
And what's making them unique?
The uniqueness is each wine coming from a different vineyard is unique to, you know, anybody else making wine from that vineyard. Elegant is just the style that we shoot for. Lighter style wines, you know, balance, not these big masculine wines that are being made. So they're on the elegant side. Just definitely those would be the two main ones that I would hope people would think. You know, these wines aren't going to be like somebody else's wine. So
well, your sourcing has been magnificent. And these are some, and I have to tell everybody, in the current wine club shipment for the first sips and then coming up for the cellar club in at the next month is his new Hallberg 2010.
Yeah.
And that is rocking and rolling. But that's a great example of a single vineyard really imparting some qualities that you are unique to that vineyard and only that vineyard and only what you selected from the vineyard.
Yeah.
Right? Because it could be a lot of different.
Yeah. I mean, I think we had 10 barrels that year from Hallberg, and we picked six or so to be in that bottling, you know?
Nice.
We've got two blocks within that vineyard that we're sourcing exclusively from. And, you know, we have our own techniques that are, you know, very minimal intervention in the winery. And, you know, hopefully we're just letting the vineyard speak for itself each year.
Well, let's start with a little Pinot. This is a single vineyard, Floodgate, 2009. You got some good scores on this, didn't you? You got a...
Yeah.
What'd you get, a 93 on...
Yeah, I think...
Or 94? What'd you get?
Enthusiast gave it a 93.
Nice.
And gave it a cellar selection. And then Berghound also reviewed this wine and gave it a 91.
Nice.
So he's more of a... You know, a Pinot fanatic, and
well, I talk about this all the time on the rating thing. Man, you get in the 90s, you're in another category, man. There's no question about it. And for a small producer to get recognition like that, that's hard. You got to be consistent, and they know that. And you read the review, and you go, oh man, they're digging what you're doing.
Yeah.
And they're understanding your consistency in the quality of the product. So.
Yeah.
Nice.
So I'm sold out of this wine, and I might end up buying it back from Scott if you guys don't.
If you guys don't get your act together, this is going to be gone. This is a beautiful, beautiful wine.
Yeah,
first of all, great
really
vintage
nice.
Year.
Yeah,
09
is great.
Has been classic. Loving it. Let's see. I poured that in a different order than the sheet. Okay, that's right. This is the 09. Floodgate, that's Russian River. Retail price on that is $42.35.70 if you're a Cellar Club member.
Mm-hmm.
Get it now or lose it. He's got to have more in his private cellar,
and
I'm the only go-to place. So
when
it's gone, baby, it's really
it's gone.
Gone.
Yeah, we'll be moving on to the 10 soon. So
10 coming in. So what's your thought on the 10? I like the Hallberg a lot. I really got to tell you. That was a tough year, man. That was a really tough year.
I haven't sat down and tried them side by side to do a comparison, but people are really enjoying the 10 as well. Kind of in
nice.
This similar style. It's a, you know, it's got a nice bright ruby red hue like this, and you know, kind of lighter style, good acidity. It should pair well with foods. We'll have to bring it in here to really see what.
Yeah,
what you think.
And we'll be the only place, because he's going to pull some back, but I'm going to hold on to some. So we'll have verticals of the 09 and 2010, and we'll be the only place on the planet you're going to be able to get that. So unless you go to his private cellar, and you know that ain't going to happen. So I'm just telling you, that's a cool thing to have. There's nothing better than to go back and have two vintages side by side.
Yeah.
And we can do that with many of the wines that we have here. So take full advantage of that.
Well, speaking of that, maybe we 08, so Appian Way Vineyards, we've been making wine since 07.
Right.
So we could do a vertical 7, 8, 9, 10.
Nice.
And I have 11 in bottle. It's just not ready to
show yet.
To show, but we could do a vertical with it for fun at some point.
See, got to love that.
Yeah.
Well, let's do that because there's nothing cooler than a vertical. I mean, it really shows, number one, it shows the consistency of your winemaking style, and then it shows what happens in the different vintage years, and it shows how these age. You know, don't worry about laying these wines down. This is 09, man. You could throw another 3, 4, 5 years or more out of that.
Yeah.
No problem at all. But don't, the caution, and I had a big talk with my wine club members that came to the event, and I'm going to keep hammering this. When we send the shipments to you, treat them as samples. I want you to treat them as samples because they're not, I don't want you to take that one bottle and stash it away because you're going to pull it out 6 or 8 months from now and you're going to go, oh my God, that was a great wine. And you'll go to order and it's gone.
Yeah.
So treat it as a sample unless we send you information that says, do not drink now. It's going to kill you. Just put it aside. Other than that, drink the wine right now. Enjoy it right now. And if you really love that, reorder, stash that away, and then you'll be the only one on the block that's got that wine.
Yeah.
Because, again, when they're gone, it's it, man. You know. So.
Yeah, we might be buying it back from you.
That's right. Now, when you come in the tasting room and you do a flight tasting, you get to enter a contest to buy a bottle of wine for a buck. Tonight, we are drawing for 8 bottles of wine. You got to love that. For $8. And I've got hundreds and hundreds of names in here, and I'm going to let you pull because they think I'm rigging it. So dig in there, man. There has got to be a winner, or we're going to have 9 next week, and
that
then
one?
Dan will win from Iowa. And then, yeah, I think that's one. There we go. Okay. Johnny Sanchez, Santa Rosa local person. Johnny Sanchez, you have won 8 bottles of wine for $8. Gotta love that, but you have to be tuned in to win. So if you get an email from me tomorrow, don't start crying, but start tuning in, because that's what we want. We want you to tune in. We do our show every single week. In fact, this is the longest webcast wine show in the world. This is the longest running show in the world. I've eclipsed everybody. There's not one. You can Google it all you want. I'm the only one that's had
that's pretty cool. A
show for almost 4 years. And I'm going through some, I found some old video. And I'm going to put together a little montage thing. It would be pretty cool.
That's cool, I bet.
Well, yeah, because, you know, when this all started, it was me and a camera. And that was it.
Yeah.
I was talking to myself. There were no viewers. There wasn't one single person that was watching.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see how it evolved over the years.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of the same format, and we, you know, but I've got a lot better guests and a lot better wine, so anyway, you got to tune in to win, and so hopefully Johnny Sanchez, is that what it is? Johnny Sanchez, you are the big winner. At least you hope you're going to be the big winner, but give us a call, 707-578-1826. Love to hear from you. Okay, so first Pinot, Russian River, Floodgate Vineyard. Lovely.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go to Elk Prairie. This is a big hit in the taster. This is, tell us where this is from and
so Elk
proximity
Prairie's
to where we are now.
It's a small 6-acre vineyard up in Humboldt County. It's about 3 hours from here, so it's a little bit of a drive. It's planted in this little green belt that's within about 20 miles of the coast, up the Eel River. It's got a pretty substantial fog bank that comes to the ridge that it sits on every night. We get a really small amount of fruit from this vineyard each year. It can be one ton to 2 tons,
okay,
which is about, you know, 2 barrels to 4 barrels. That's
not a lot of wine,
no,
pal.
It's not much at all. 09 was the 4-barrel year. It was a good year. But, you know, I just think it's one of those unique wines that we make. I mean,
wow.
And I think there's something to be said about the terroir up there. You know, eventually I think it could be somewhat of a wine-growing region in the maybe next 20 years.
Well, it's making great Pinot, so yeah. Are they growing anything else up there? Is it just...
just grapes.
Oh, well, yeah, that's right. Well, that's right. Well, if you guys get hungry when you have this, it's Humboldt County.
Yeah. There are a couple
comes
other
with brownies. When you buy the wine, we give you a little brownie because you'll be hungry, we know.
There are a couple other vineyards up there planted.
All Pinot? Or is it
a little bit of Chardonnay?
There's
some Syrah in warmer inland areas, you know.
As
you
get there is that oddity. It can grow in that other climate where
yeah.
it's a little cooler.
As you go further inland, too, there's a little area called Willow Creek, which is further north.
Mm-hmm.
And there's I think there's some Merlot and Cab growing up there. But it's inland and it's trapped. There's no fog influence.
Okay.
So it gets hot, you know, kind of like anything inland from here, you know, gets warmer.
Right.
Similar type of thing there. But I haven't had a whole lot of wines from up there that were, you know, as interesting as I think Pinot Noir can be grown in the right areas up there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's making a beautiful wine. Retail on that is $39, $33.15 if you're a Cellar Club member. So we got to love love that wine. And again, small production, nice. Right? 100 cases. Yeah, it's pouring really nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a whole lot of wine there.
No.
No.
It's, I think we're down to 15 cases. And then the issue with, unfortunate thing about this wine is there won't be a preceding vintage until hopefully this year.
Is that right?
Yeah, 2010 we made the rosé.
Right.
So we didn't make a red wine, just didn't really get to the proper ripeness. 11 and 12, we didn't get any fruit that year. It was just too light of a crop. So
if you guys want it, you got to get it because it's gone, it's over, and nothing in front of it except for maybe this year.
Yeah, so you're looking at another 2 years, 3 years from now before we release it.
Yeah, and so you need to buy at least 5 or 6 cases each and then hang on to that, right? and then dole it out over the next couple of years
there
and
you'll
be all set. Because when you taste this, you're really loving life. I use it as a go-to wine downstairs. Mm-hmm. You know, when somebody says, give me an exceptional Pinot, and I just, boom, pull it out, and they're like, nice. That's beautiful. I always know I'm going to catch that Mr. Pinot.
That's good.
Yeah, they can't argue when they taste that. It's beautiful.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
You know, the Psalms in the city love it too because it's something that they don't have on there. They're always looking, you know, they're looking for that interesting wine that nobody else has. And
it's got it all. Small production in an area where you don't see a whole lot of Pinot.
So yeah.
Got to love that. Now, coming up this week, we've got, we're done with barrel tasting. Thank God that's done. It was very fun. We had a good time. But this weekend, we've got Thursday, Ricky Allen Ray, new time, 5:30 till 8:30. He'll be here. And then on Friday, we've got John Pita at 7:30 till 10:30, right up here in the library lounge where we're doing the show tonight. And then on Saturday is Falcon Christopher. And, man, has he been rocking the house. So Falcon Christopher in the house. You never know who's going to show up. He always rockers show up every once in a while. Oh, so. Yeah. That's always fun. And also we've put our date together for the lobster lunch coming up in June on the 29th. So sign up for that. It'll be a great time. And we're booking some other new stuff, and we're working on some things for the summer. So we'll come up with some fun activities.
Cool.
And we'll get the Joseph Jewell team back in here and on some meet and greets and get you guys in for TV Tuesday to launch the Halberg, because that wine is smoking good.
Yeah.
Smoking good. All right, so let's go to the Zinfandel. Tell us about the Grist Vineyard. This is 2008.
Yeah, Grist is a...
Another wine you sold out of.
Yeah. I know. Well, we got the 09, so unlike the Elk Prairie, we have a vintage behind it. But Grist Vineyard is it's in Dry Creek Valley. But it's not in the valley. It's actually up on top of a ridge called Bradford Mountain, which is on the west side of Dry Creek. It sits at about 1,000 feet elevation. It's in this red volcanic soil, so it's got some interesting characteristics that the vines really enjoy. They thrive up there.
Yeah, it looks like Georgia.
Yeah,
the red soil.
Yeah, so it's different than most of Dry Creek Valley. You know, it's the soil type really distinguishes it, and the climate, because it's up a little bit, you know. It's during the summer, the heat can kind of get trapped down in the valley and can be really warm and maybe too warm in some years for Zinfandel. Mm-hmm. So this has got some coastal cooling and, you know, it's a great place for Zinfandel. It's a unique vineyard site. 40-year-old vines. This vineyard was the mother vineyard for most of the local vineyards in Dry Creek. They were coming and taking budwood off of these vines and grafting them onto rootstock and planting most of the Zinfandel vineyards around Dry Creek. So it's got some history as well. The 08 is a really nice lighter style Zin, which suits our winemaking techniques. It's kind of Pinot-esque in my mind. You know, it's not big, ripe, jammy fruit. It's more elegant. You got fresh fruits.
A little spice.
Yeah.
Getting in the nose.
It's got a good amount of spice.
And that's really a Dry Creek area characteristic that we noticed a lot.
But if you were to see this wine just based on the appearance alone, you would think it's
Did you bring me my dinner? You did. How nice. We had some guests come up and brought me dinner. I love that. How'd you know what I wanted? That's pretty good.
Yeah. It's kind of got, it's got a color that would be similar to a Pinot. I've seen Pinot with more color than this.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's a lighter, it's lighter, a lighter Zinfandel, but,
style. But, if you
but
want
not
that
lacking
fruit,
anything.
You want that fruit, you've got it.
Yeah.
Well, it's a beautiful vineyard. I have to say, I've been there. We used to have Bradford Mountain as a, one of our vintners here in the room.
Uh-huh.
And we had a barbecue there and almost sank a limo bus, man. That was so funny.
Yeah,
I wish I had a picture of that. I promised the limo company I'd never show the picture, but it's sitting like this almost in that pond.
In the pond?
You know the pond, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's the funniest damn thing you ever saw in your whole life. And I was videotaping going, please go in, please go in, please go in, please
go in. Oh, man.
I'm going, and then I thought, and then the senses came back. And
that
I
would have been the end of it.
I was going to say.
Yeah.
You know, that's a...
no more visits to Grist for...
Well, and aren't they organic? Is that organic over there?
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, that would have taken that organic thing with that diesel. It wouldn't have been good, but it sure would have been funny.
Something to talk about.
Oh yeah, we got a question. Let's go to Karina.
All right. So this question is coming from Dizelle, and he would like to know if you can name a few things that you've learned since you first started making wine that has improved the quality of your wines.
Oh, a few things.
wow. How many hours do you have?
Yeah. Well, I started in 06 in the garage, so with Micah. And so that was, I was pretty green at that point in time. I learned a lot. I don't even know if, I mean, winemaking isn't just winemaking, it's also logistics. You know, that's one thing.
Oh, God, yeah.
You know, it's getting the fruit to the winery on time when you're processing, it's getting your glass and all that stuff organized for a bottling. So there's a lot of that, which is not really the fun side of it.
No.
But winemaking wise, that all helps us put together a nice product in the end. But, you know, I think Mike and I are adapting over the years to dial in each vineyard, because the first few years we're learning how our style is reacting with the vineyard. So over the period of 3 years, we feel like of working with one vineyard, we're figuring out how to farm it properly, how to manage the crop loads and how they react different blocks. So each year, we're dialing in each vineyard. So as you see, the wines that we've been making for 5 and 6 years, we've figured out those vineyards pretty well. Because if we don't figure them out, we'll move on to another place that works out.
Well, and it's got to start there, man. And there's lots of places you can go.
Yeah.
There's lots of vineyards that you can go to, without a doubt.
Yeah.
And you've picked some really nice locations. I mean, these are all world-class vineyards.
Yeah.
That, you also have to know who to get in and get that stuff.
You got to make the right relationships.
Yeah.
One other thing we've done, we haven't tasted it here, but we've, over the years, we've taken samples out of tank before bottling and before we filtered Pinot Noir, and revisited those over the last few years and came to a consensus that we think our wine style would be better served if we didn't fine and filter the Pinots. So that's one thing we've added over the years is the 2010 Pinots and going forward are all unfined, unfiltered. So that's one thing that I could say that, I think we've learned about our wines that.
And I prefer that actually. I don't have an issue when you get a bottle of wine, you pour it down at the end, you get a little sediment. That's a good thing. Mm-hmm. That's in there for a reason. It's really adding to the wine, don't you think? I mean,
and these wines aren't going to be. They're not going to be dirty, and there's not going to be a lot of lees in them in the first few years. That could happen over the period of, 5-10 years. They've all been settled and racked clean of any sediment. So they're going to be clean when you drink them. Just because they're unfined, unfiltered, doesn't mean they're going to have a bunch of, lees substance in the bottom of the bottle.
Yeah.
But over the period of a few years, you might see that a little more than the filtered stuff. But
yeah,
like Scott said, that's a good thing.
Oh, it's a great thing. Don't ever have a problem with that. No.
Yeah.
This Zinfandel. $33 retail on that, $28.05 if you're a Cellar Club member. If you're not a wine club member and you like the wines, you're missing the opportunity. You're missing the idea that you get access to these small production wines. You're not going to go to your local Safeway in Iowa and in Chicago and pick up these wines, man. No. It's just going to be really damn hard to find. And you get a little break in price point. That's a bonus, man. That's a total bonus. And you get to come to the tasting room and meet the winemaker. And heck, I've got a winemaker in here almost every week. So that's pretty good.
Yeah.
And these guys are really fun and nice, and you guys are always a hit, and people really connect with you, mm-hmm. And your counterpart there, Mike.
That's good, yeah.
That's a bonus, man. That's you know, real fun stuff.
So, yeah. Well, we want people to know who's making the wine and understand the story and why we're doing it, too. So if you're ever here, let us know, and we'll come down and meet you for a drink.
Yeah, there you go. We can always do that, so never, never, never forget. Yeah.
Well, are they doing a meet and greet soon?
We did one a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
But
that's always a good
I think we've got something plugged in. Well, but we'll let you guys know. And we've been holding those on Thursdays. So it'll be a Thursday meet and greet. You get to meet the winemaker. And we keep access, and you can't get that anywhere else. Let's do one more drawing for fun.
All right.
Let's see if we can catch somebody that's tuned in. Maybe Dan's name's in there. Let me stir it up. Dan, you're in there, I promise. Giselle, you're in there. Sean, you're in there. I'm just telling.
Those guys are always tuned in.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They're in here?
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. I'll try and find them.
There you go. All right. Well, I mean, now they're going to say we cooked the books, you know.
No, I'm not. But, you know, I'm not cheating.
Whatever, you know, the bottom line is you got to be tuned in to win. That's how there's no secret. All right, who is it?
Is that a first name? Adrian Paul?
Adrian Paul?
That's a last name.
Or Paul Adrian. Let's see. No, it must be Adrian Paul. That's kind of how they did.
Oh, huh. Two first names.
Their
two
email.
First names, yeah.
Adrian Paul. Adrian Paul. Oh, Santa Rosa, your local Santa Rosa person. You have won 8 bottles of wine or a email from me telling you how this thing really, really works. With no excuse. We're open, for God's sakes. You just come in. It's no big deal.
Yeah.
Yeah. Got to love it. So recap on what's coming up this week. We've got, again, Ricky Allen Ray on Thursday. So come on down Thursday night with Ricky Allen Ray. And then John Pita on Friday. And then we have Falcon Christopher. Great show. Here in the tasting room. And now you can order dinner from 2 restaurants and have them delivered. Sushi to Die For. Mm-hmm. Great sushi if you're into sushi. That's the place, and they'll deliver it right here. And then Jack and Tony's. They've been delivering for a couple of years. And Jack and Tony's also does our food and wine pairing, which we do.
Oh, nice.
Monday through Saturday from 1 to 5. So always fun stuff to do. We'll keep you entertained. Also, we'll help you with your plans. If you're ever going to visit wine country, call the tasting room. We'll map things out for you, mm-hmm. and help you with hotel and restaurant recommendations, and we've got it dialed. I know where all the cool places are. Just trust me. And what you want to do is you want to make sure, I usually am off on Wednesdays, so if you want to come visit wine country and you want the best tour on the planet, come make sure that you plug it in with me. I'll take you around and show you I know all the great little wineries to go to.
Nice.
None of the big ones. We won't go to any big ones. Just forget that. We love their wine, but too bad. We're going to go. I know where all the cool little joints are that are out there in wine country. So I'll help you with your vacation, which, you know, summer's coming up. So, you know, the weather's changing. Yeah. Although it's trying to. Oh, it is wet. No, it's not. It's. Oh, that's wet. It's rain. Is it raining? Like
definitely
real rain?
Raining.
Okay, real rain is here. We're just crying, but it's going to be in the 70s this weekend. It'll be beautiful. So sorry, Dan. Yeah, sorry, Giselle. Well, well. Oh, you have a question? Go ahead. Karina, go over there and catch that question. But she's going to wait. He's going to get a microphone right on you.
Is there any chance to ever catch Joseph Jewell in a winemaker dinner or sort of special event?
With sellers?
Oh, yeah.
We'll do it.
A winemaker dinner anytime anybody wants to do that. Uh-huh. It just comes down to bodies. If we can get enough people, it probably takes about 25 or 30 people to make an event like that. Absolutely, absolutely. I can talk these guys into it big time. They like food and they like wine. There's no question about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it just comes down to support. You bet. Absolutely. In fact, we can work with our buddy Jack at Jack and Tony's and have something over there anytime we want.
Let's do it.
Yeah, that's easy.
Yeah.
We can do that. We got lots of access.
Okay.
You guys are coming, right?
Yeah, I'll show up.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. All right. I want to thank all of my bloggers. Next week, get ready. We're going to taste. I've got Dunant in the house. I've got Greg LaFollette coming in.
Nice.
And we're going to taste the Montrey 2006 pre-release that was in the wine club shipment. My bloggers will all be tasting with us. Dan and Sean and Grace and Dazelle and all you guys, you've got the wine, so we'll be tasting right along with it. A few weeks after that, down the calendar, we'll have this guy back in, and we'll taste that Hallberg wine because it's rocking.
I'm looking forward to that.
And we'll get that out to the bloggers as well, so we all have the wine. So I want to thank you for...
thanks for having me, Scott.
Yep, for coming down and telling us about your cool wines. I want to thank you for tuning in, and this is where you discover wine one sip at a time. Here at Cellars of Sonoma. We'll see you next week. Dunant will be in the house and Greg LaFollette. Bye for now.
Cheers.